It's a pleasure knowing you're watching the program Meet the Press on Equinox Television. Cameroon is still in search of a Senate president after almost a week when the upper house began meeting in the nation's capital, that is Yaoundé. In this edition of program, we talk National Day celebrations. What actually happened on May 20, 1972? That will be the subject of discussion with our guest. And then the University of Boya is still boiling with another crisis. We hear so far cars have been destroyed, lectures have been grounded. Welcome to join us in this edition of your program. Thanks for staying with us. Traditionally, we begin with our human interest stories, and surprisingly, we hear at least three persons were killed after a building collapse on a church premises in the economic capital Douala. Our field reporters compiled the following package in the guise of our news briefs.
The land problem between inhabitants of Cité Beige and the Dubois family in the Douala 3 subdivision, littoral region of Cameroon, has been pulling on for over 25 years. Some inhabitants are still questioning a collective land title brandished by the Dubois family to claim ownership of the land. During a consultation meeting between the two parties and the divisional officer for the Douala 3 subdivision, the latter made it clear that it has been proven that the land title is authentic. He further stated that the problem has shifted from questions on the land title to the payment of a symbolic amount of money by inhabitants to the Dubois family in view of obtaining their land titles. The land problem concerns only inhabitants of Cité Beige 1 and 2. Cité Beige 3 is out of a limit stated in the land title. Following an accord signed in 2002 by the representative of the Dubois family and the headquarters representing the population, some inhabitants are said to have already paid some money to the Dubois family and are in possession of their land titles. A great proportion of the inhabitants of this neighborhood, originally known as Bidudungu, have not paid the money requested by the Dubois family. Time has passed, and the money expected from the population has equally changed.
This incident brings a number to two men who have lost their lives in the course of constructing this story building here at Douche Municipal. The second victim, just like the first, fell off from the third floor after the rope he used to climb gave way. The man in his 30s had his bones scattered and he was bleeding profusely even through the mouth. He was rushed to the hospital by some benevolent persons. We got information on the field that he died while in the taxi. This other young guy says he had earlier worked as a laborer here for just 30,000 francs a month for work which he says should be done for about 200,000 francs at least. Security forces were at the scene to open investigations. Business persons in the town of Beto are still counting their losses after the contents of over 15 shops were consumed by ravaging flames. The incident began at about 11 p.m. when the traders had already closed their shops. The actual cause of the fire has not yet been established. Eyewitnesses say the flames began after sparks were spotted from a tailoring workshop. Fire incidents have been recurrent in markets in Beto, and the situation is made worse with the absence of a firefighting brigade. The material and financial losses incurred in this fire disaster is estimated at millions of francs CFA.
This is part of the one-story building that has killed three persons. According to witnesses, it collapsed at about 7 p.m. on a church Tuesday. The three victims include a pregnant woman and her son, who were living in the upper section of the building, and a member of the church. The pastor of the church reportedly asked Christians to move out of the church house when he noticed that the building could collapse. One of the Christians, a young man said to be a pianist, later went back into the church house to get his piano when the building collapsed on him. It took several hours for firefighters to extract the latter's mortal remains from debris. Unofficial sources say the building in the Ndokoti neighborhood in Douala, littoral region of Cameroon, had been existing for about 20 years. Few meters away from this place, we saw another building in the same state. Parts of the building are already falling off, yet on one of the doors it is written, Deux chambres à louer, that is, two rooms to let. On the upper section, there are indications of human occupation, despite its dilapidated state.
Now we take you to the regions for happenings within the week, and we noticed that the University of Boya was boiling the students when on the rampage, destroying university property, demanding a series of wide-ranging reforms. This is our regional network.
The coming of the rainy season is putting the locals of the far north region mal at ease. The fear that the catastrophe which befell them in 2012 might repeat itself if precautionary measures are not taken. But there seems to be very little to worry about. In the year 2012, the far north region was hit by inundation, which caused enormous damages. The Ministry of Territorial Administration is involved in various phases, the prevention, preparation, intervention, and realization of reconstruction fees. A dike is under construction to ensure that water from the River Logon, which caused floods in Mayore and its environs, is blocked. Bulldozers and other engines are presently at work now. The various phases of prevention are being supervised by elements of the Military Engineering Unit in the far north region.
This is Ndifor Robert, the suspected bandit. Age 18, he fell into the drug net of the police during a night patrol Sunday. Questioned by police officer Basso David, he revealed that he had broken into a store at Alakuma and another one few meters away from Full Gospel entrance at the Bamenda Foot Market Hill.
On Sunday morning, I realized that they have break into my place. And what made me to recognize that it was a young man who came to buy that thing. They showed me on the phone. By the time I look at the audio and sound mixer, I did not find it. I recognized that that was a guy. But so lucky, rapid caught the guy. So on seeing the guy, I recognized the guy that it was the guy who wanted to buy that appliance. So many appliances have been missing there, but I don't know. I only recognized it after.
The suspected thief is said to have burgled several shops in Alakuma, where he lives.
What these gentlemen are doing is termed technology-related distractions while on the road.
No, I was doing it because it was only agent, because maybe it was an international call. Probably if I drop it, I may find it difficult again to get in touch with a person. Okay. That was why I did it. I know that was not correct. But I have no choice at that particular moment. But I could not do that at the middle of the road. I have to cross the road very fast and answer my call.
Bad road user behavior is one of the leading contributors to road fatalities and injuries. Driver distraction, such as phoning on the wheel, sending a text message, or tweeting while driving, is also extremely dangerous. Over 1 million people die and others injured because drivers are manipulating communication systems and entertainment options like music, radio, TV, or social media in their vehicles while driving. ICTs and improving road safety is the theme of this year's World Telecommunication and Information Society Day.
Flag flying at half mast, a car set on fire. Forces of law and order ushered out of the campus, and when these policemen reinforced and came back, they exploded tear gas, even in the surrounding neighborhood, Moliku. Witnesses, especially the Kampo police, who were trashed in this office by the students, will find it hard to forget what they term a day of terror. Mr. Akko Julius is the advisor to the Southwest Youth Association.
We are calling on the police people to be orderly. Police people were spraying tear gas into the quarters that affected even little children.
These students say the reasons for their strike are as follows. That the presidential grant should be given to students having as from 2 GPA, not as from 3. All the court charges levied on the student leaders should be uplifted. Allow elections of the University of Buya Student Union to be conducted as to the norms of the union. And the number of receipt courses should be increased, among others. In a telephone interview with an administrator of the University of Buya, he said the students causing unrest on campus are not the University of Buya Student Union members, but are a handful of students who have decided to disrupt classes, and the school administrators will take the necessary measures. To Mr. Eban Williams, president of the Southwest Youth Association, dialogue should be part of every step that is to be taken now.
We want to call on the administration and the student body to sit down and try to dialogue to make sure that any form of violence is discontinued.
Now we talk politics. We know Elections Cameroon has decided again to reopen registration using the biometric kits. Elecam says that process will go on until when the electorate is convened. Nobody knows exactly when. And also within the week, we saw how Cameroon was battling to have the first ever Senate president as the upper house meets in the nation's capital, Yaoundé. This is 1 week of Politiking, a compilation of Roland.
Yumo Kupit Adamu is the supporter of the CDU party who turned down President Biya's senatorial appointment. At this press briefing in Yaoundé Monday,
que je remercie le chef de l'État pour la confiance qu'il m'a faite en me nommant sénateur suppléant mercredi dernier.
He expressed his gratitude to the head of state for the appointment, but regrettably, he will not accept it.
Mais je décline très humblement cette nomination.
Kumit Adamu says, as supporter and Politburo member of the CDU party, it is unacceptable for him to be alternate to a Politburo member of the CPDM party in the person of Ibrahim Bombonjoya, the Sultan of the Bamoun.
Sur le plan politique, cet acte ne trouve pas son sens.
45 years old Kumit adds,
j'ai été surpris et déçu de constater que je figure parmi les personnalités nommées par le président de la République.
He told reporters he has been receiving anonymous threat calls for snubbing President Biya's appointment.
Ça n'a aucune incidence sur le fonctionnement institutionnel.
Abdou Karimou, an expert in electoral affairs, says the law does not say anything about a senator who rejects an appointment and that the president will decide whether to appoint another person or not. With 8 councils and over 200 municipal councillors, the CDU party of Adamu Ndamjoya has no senator. It was a formidable festive atmosphere outside the National Assembly as the pioneer senators arrive for their first statutory ordinary session of the Senate. Traditional dance group from all the regions of Cameroon celebrate the election and appointment of the pioneer senators. Supporters of the 6 political parties present in the Senate were also outside the National Assembly. The National Vice President of the SDF Party and the son of Ni John Frundi represented the SDF Party at the event. Some of the arrivals were spectacular, especially the arrival of this Frundi MP, escorted by his protocol officers. the vehicle of Senator Dakole Daisala almost caught fire. He was escorted to the assembly inside the vehicle of the convoy of the Minister of Defense.
We have come all the way from Boom in Boyo Division, very, very far, just to come and say thank you for electing our son, one Lord John Chemua, as a senator in Cameroon.
Menchum Division, Wumsop. We have our senator here, by name Walang David Akwo. So we are very happy, though we needed four.
We have two senators, for Tabetando and Chief Dr. Anja Simon.
Chief Tabetando from Manu Division.
We are here celebrating the victory of His Royal Majesty the Fon of Fontem, who was elected as senator.
We came here to chat up with our big elite, our fathers, who have been given the opportunity to be senators in this country. Yes.
The chairman of the SDF party receives the Sultan of the Bamoun at his Omispor residence after the opening plenary of the Senate. Sultan Ibrahim Bombonjoya says he came at the invitation of the SDF chairman Nijon Frundi. The chairman admits he invited the Sultan to share with him during the reception offered to his 14th Senate. The Sultan is an influential CPDM supporter in the West region, where supporters of the party cast their votes in favor of the SDF, which grabbed all the 7 seats of the Senate in the region. The chairman also received the Lamido of Tinye from the Adamawa region. The SDF party grabbed all the 7 seats of the Senate in the Adamawa. The senatorial reception at Chairman Frundi's Yaoundé residence was aimed at giving the party's blessings to the 14 senators to go and serve the people.
I've come to congratulate them and wish them well and success in their deliberations in the senatorial house, and to tell them that they should take note that is the party investing and sending them to Senate. They are not going in their individual capacities, so they have to listen to the instructions and the directives of the party. Cameroonians voted them to go in as senators, and that their service should be geared towards serving the Cameroonian people.
In Cameroon, the head of state alone knows the electoral calendar. What the Coalition for Democratic Governance believes is not normal.
In a normal democracy, those things should be known. Every election that is fixed has a date which is known well ahead of time. Somebody should be able to tell you 2 years ahead of time that the elections will hold in such and such a date.
The Coalition is also against the fact that the president is having to appoint 30 out of 100 senators, leaving Cameroonians to elect 70.
We think there's a difference between somebody who is elected and somebody who is appointed, and these two cannot be sitting at the same table to argue about the laws of the country.
For the upcoming twin council and parliamentary elections, the coalition has already identified a danger that poses for the state.
The law says that we have 90 days between the convening of the electorate for the other elections. Now, if that's going to happen, then between 90 days and the 60 days that the parliamentarians have, there will be 30 days of void, during which we don't have a parliament. So how is the country going to run during that period?
These remarks were made in Yaoundé Thursday, as the Coalition for Democratic Governance publishes its observation results of the senatorial election.
We noticed, for example, that there was corruption. that there was a corruption of voters. There was the use of state property for campaigns, which is wrong. We noticed, for example, also that women did not have a fair representation. We noticed that people with disabilities did not have proper representation also.
Useful remarks for future elections.
I think it is an action that should be praised because it enables us to be in conformity with the law. In the political dimension, it solves the problem of political parties that were already complaining about the situation. This is the kind of measures that we need to have a political landscape that functions on the basis of a consensus concerning electoral issues.
Consensus en ce qui concerne les affaires électorales.
L'ECAM était dans l'illégalité. Il n'avait pas de droit.
L'ECAM was in illegality. It did not have the right to stop registration of potential voters. We put pressure, and I think that L'ECAM has responded. I praise the initiative, even though it comes late. If they were listening to us before now, many more Cameroonians would have registered, but even if it's just a week, it proves that they are beginning to listen to us and things will change.
Preuve qu'on commence à être écouté et qu'il y aura changement d'ici peu.
And that's exactly the senatorial ambience we are witnessing here. Roland Akong, Equinox TV, Yaoundé.
Thank you, televiewers, for the confidence and for staying with us. We are now with our guests, and you all know we are within the context of 20th May celebrations. He is a historian and also a political observer based in Boya in the southwest region of Cameroon. I'm talking about Rischard Ndifor. Welcome to join us in the program, Prof.
Thank you for having me.
I'm going to be interviewing you with Roland Djotie Joseph. He works with the French language daily newspaper Le quotidien d'économie. Time for you to welcome, Prof. Joe.
Merci, professeur. Et tout de suite, j'aimerais déjà vous poser une question, puisque vous venez de la ville de Boya, où nous savons tous qu'il y a une grève qui secoue cette université depuis mardi. Alors, vous qui venez de Boya, quelles sont les dernières nouvelles, Prof?
Well, by the time I left Boya, the situation was relatively calm. There were no more destruction of properties, but then the students are still not called off the strike. They are still bent on the fact that their 5-point grievances should be addressed before the strike is called off. But then I think, as an observer, what is happening in the University of Boya is really sad. I'll start by saying that there is no problem that is solved with violence. And so the students should be calm and try to use other civilized means to get their problems solved. There are other means by which they can express their dissatisfaction without necessarily going into the destruction of properties. Because when they destroy properties, it is they who suffer at the end of the day. So it is my hope that they addressed this issue calmly and peacefully too. They are made in other means. They have the right to express their dissatisfaction, no doubt. But that should be done in a more civilized manner. They might have a sit-down strike. They might have a peaceful demonstration without necessarily going out.
Mais à condition qu'ils ne soient pas provoqués, on a également appris, selon, n'est-ce pas, les propos des responsables YUPSU, l'association, n'est-ce pas, des étudiants de l'Université de Boya, qu'ils auraient été provoqués par des vigiles. Il se trouve, n'est-ce pas, que les vigiles se sont pris, ont pris à partie deux ou trois étudiants qu'ils molestaient, les soupçonnant d'appartenir à YUPSU. C'est donc cela, n'est-ce pas, qui aurait donc déclenché la colère des étudiants qui, mardi dernier, ont décidé, n'est-ce pas, d'ériger des barricades aux différentes entrées du campus. Donc, est-ce que vous ne pensez pas qu'il est aussi important que l'administration ne se livre pas à des scènes de provocation?
No, that is, we are very correct there. I think, in my humble opinion, that the administration of the University of Boya should employ dialogue in the handling of this situation rather than using force. Force will not solve the problem. In my humble opinion, looking at what the the students are asking for. It's not such a difficult demand to grant. Of course, I don't know how far the administration of Boya has gone to address that situation. But I think that rather than using force, rather than having an adamant method of solving the problem, they should call them and have an open-minded discussion with these students and try to see how the problem is resolved peacefully, because it is not in the best interest of the university that property and the university properties are destroyed.
Now, from the recent information, we hear the administration held a meeting. The committee of deans and directors met. They decided that,
à l'absence des étudiants, bien sûr,
in the absence of the students, from information at our disposal, mm-hmm. and decided that the 2,500 francs, which has been paid students when they take part in national day celebrations, be maintained. That the students' union be temporarily suspended with immediate effect. Those are the resolutions after the meeting, and we're equally made to understand that the administration equally said that the problem of the president's grant to students is not managed by the University of Boya, but by the Minister of Higher Education. That was just complimentary information.
Okay.
I was about to ask you, as a resident of Boya, how did the strike in the university affect you negatively, positively? And when you have recurrent strike actions in that university, how do you feel?
Yeah, like I express a lot of dissatisfaction. I'm not very happy with the fact that such a situation should be taking place in the University of Boya. It doesn't really affect the residents of the University of Boya, except for those who live at the immediate residence of immediate surrounding of the student residential area of Moliko. Apart from there, it didn't really affect the entire Boya resident. But let me come on one thing you raised there about the situation of the handling of funds given to the given by the President of the Republic. That is what has baffled me for quite some time. I don't understand for what reason the president is granting, for what purpose, what is the president's purpose of granting this 50,000 francs? Because if truly it is genuinely a scholarship, why don't just commute it into school fees, so that we say that for that year, the students don't pay fee. Rather than us going to distribute 50,000 francs to students, and then they go around the university surrounding and drinking and getting themselves drunk, and sometimes they even go to borrow drinks with the hope that they will have this money to pay for it, and when it doesn't come, we find the type of situation we are finding. So I can't understand why this scholarship is not just being converted into fees for the students in the university, so that we know that those who qualify to have that grant should be should not pay their fees for that particular academic year, and that is converted from
Is at the discretion of the president of the republic.
That is why we have to question why. Why that?
The president
that
is watching you
as money.
One day provide you answer to the question.
Mais prof, vous, we made that answer. Vous êtes historien, vous êtes en même temps observateur politique, et ce n'est pas, en fait, s'agissant de la grève de Boya, Madame le recteur accuse, en fait, déclare que les étudiants, n'est-ce pas, de Boya sont manipulés, seraient manipulés par des esprits malins tapis dans l'ombre. Vous qui êtes observateur politique, comment est-ce que vous analysez, n'est-ce pas, de tels propos? Est-ce que vous pensez que les étudiants de Boya sont suffisamment immatures pour ne pas savoir comment revendiquer leurs droits pour être manipulés par des esprits mal intentionnés tapis dans l'ombre?
Yes, that is always the talk coming up from politicians. This time a group of individuals want to express their dissatisfaction with the state of affairs. Mm-hmm. There is always this statement of they are being manipulated by politicians and all of that. I cannot tell for sure if they are being manipulated by politicians. But I think politics should be kept out of this. That is why I said mm-hmm. there should be an open-minded discussion on the issue. Mm-hmm. And they look at the issue at stake and look at what the students are asking for. Look at them and try to see how these problems could be resolved. And again, we talk of the issue of paying money for students to match to participate during the National Day. I think participation of students are some sign of patriotism to their mm-hmm. country. Mm-hmm. And I do not believe, in my personal opinion, that students have to be paid to participate to show
it's
loyalty
kind of refreshment
to the nation.
Fee.
No.
Because after the march pass,
then we'll have to go right down
to primary
schools to start
and nursery school.
Nursery school, primary school, and secondary school students for participating.
The funds will be available. Now, we are within the context of the celebration of 50 years of Cameroon's reunification. It is a historic event. the town of Boya will be host to the event, and the president is eventually going to be there to celebrate with his compatriots. The question is, how prepared is Boya? You are somebody who observes what is going on in terms of material preparation. Do you think the president might visit Boya too soon?
No, I don't think so. I don't think there is a possibility of the president coming to Boya
immediately
in the very near future, because there is still a whole lot of work to be done in the in Boya. Considering that by the time I left Boya, there were a lot of caterpillars on the road. There was a lot of work going on in Boya, and I think there is still so much work to be done.
In which areas, to be precise?
Presently, they are doing work on the main road where they
are. From My17 to Boya Town.
Yes, from My17 to Boya Town, where they are undoing the median.
Are they also trying to enlarge the roads?
That is what they are trying to do, which is again is worrisome to me. Why such a project should be carried on for the road to be destroyed? Of course, the explanation is that they needed a larger space for the president to pass through. But the question is, what were these leaders thinking? The original conception of that project, they did not look into the future, which is the problem with our leaders, the lack of foresight. Mm-hmm. They would have earmarked, they would have known that the town of Boya will not remain what it is. What it was, it will evolve and it will be bigger than what they were seeing, and that there will come a time when the president of the republic will come to Boya, and that not only the president, what about the Pope, if the Pope had to visit Boya, or even the president of the United States. And so I think that those were some of the things our leaders would have thought over by the time the road was constructed, because this is the waste of taxpayers' money, in my opinion. This is waste of taxpayers' money. We don't use taxpayers' money as if, and then we cry and we say we don't have money, and then we put so much money in such construction and then turn around again, destroy.
Mais à vous entendre, prof, les élites du Sud-Ouest peuvent s'énerver. Ils peuvent dire que c'est pas vrai, parce que on sait très bien que depuis des mois, depuis 2010, les élites cotisent beaucoup d'argent, notamment sous la houlette de député Mafani Moussongue, qui est en quelque sorte
le local coordination organizing committee,
coordinateur local, n'est-ce pas?
In preparation
for the event, we have raised 200 million. Now, maybe we want to ask him. We noticed that all the development projects are focused on Fako Division. What about Libi Alem, Kupe Maninguba Division? Yeah, what do you think the locals might be having as impression in that the wake of what is going on?
That is the situation. And most especially a place like Bangem and other places like Kupe Maninguba. Especially Kupe Maninguba, I've worked in that area, and the roads leading to those areas are quite inaccessible. Mm-hmm. And I begin to wonder how those people will be able to move even to Boya, because the focus is only around Fako, and as if the other people of the region, Mundimba, Bakasi, and all of that, will not be part of this ceremony. They will have to move from their different places to meet in Boya. And how do they get access to that area with the poor roads that they have? So I think it was necessary for the roads, those inaccessible roads and that of Manfi, to be
given maybe some consideration.
Exactly.
Now, on to our focus. We are talking reunification. It's a political event, and we know 20th May 1972. How did we get to 20th May 1972? That is what people seem not to understand. Every year we see Cameroonians marching across ceremonial grounds. People don't try to find out what actually transpired before we got to where we are today. So take us memory lane, Prof.
Okay. I think this whole issue started a very long time ago. I would not like to take us right back when Cameroon was partitioned between Britain and British and French Cameroon. That was in 1916 and was confirmed in 1919. I will start with Fumban after the plebiscite, when British Southern Cameroonians unanimously voted in a UN-conducted plebiscite in favor of reunification with La Republique du Cameroun. We will understand that one factor that worked in favor of reunification was the fact that those leaders in British Southern Cameroon who propagated their idea of reunification, they assured British Southern Cameroonians that the union between British Southern Cameroon and French Cameroon will be conducted on the basis of a federal structure. And that was what motivated many British Southern Cameroonians, of course, because by the time they were in association with Nigeria, they were an autonomous region within the Nigerian Federation. And so they saw that, they thought that it would be a federal structure. And so after the plebiscite, the politician, yeah, in 1961, the politicians of British Southern Cameroon and those of La République du Cameroun met in Fumban to come out with a draft constitution as to how the union between the two is going to look like. And but before they even met in Fumban, they had met, politicians of British Southern Cameroon had met in Bamenda to come out with a proposal of what they want, how they want this union between La République du Cameroun and French Cameroon to look like. And one of the issues they stressed on was the fact that it should be a loose federation, one where the federated states have more powers, and that the president of the republic should be a ceremonial head of state. But unfortunately for them, when they got to Fumban, it turned out that why they came to Fumban with a proposal, the delegation from La République du Cameroun came out with something that looked like a clearly written constitution. And what came out at the end of the day in Fumban was overwhelmingly what Ahidjo had thought of. And you will understand that even in Fumban,
So what did they do with the document which was earlier prepared in Bamenda?
Yeah, what was prepared in Bamenda was a proposal and was submitted to the delegation of La République du Cameroun prior to their meeting in Fumban to have a look at it, so that by the time they have discussion in Fumban, they can intelligently debate on the issue. But unfortunately, British Southern Cameroonians did not have a copy of what came from what the La République du Cameroun had as their own proposal, call it that, because it was actually some form of a clearly written constitution than a proposal.
But par contre, prof, excusez-moi de vouloir vous interrompre, il y a des responsables, n'est-ce pas, du gouvernement de la partie francophone de l'époque qui attestent de ce que les leaders, ou bien, n'est-ce pas, les responsables de la partie anglophone du pays étaient bien d'accord. Ils avaient, n'est-ce pas, participé à l'élaboration de la mouture finale de cette constitution-là, notamment les Solomon Tandemouna, John Gofoncha et bien d'autres. Et même Fon Moukete, qui est en ce moment le président du bureau provisoire du Sénat. Donc, ils ont notamment travaillé ensemble avec leurs frères de la partie francophone à l'élaboration de ce document. Alors, sur quoi est-ce que vous vous appuyez pour dire que Ahidjo, n'est-ce pas, avait concocté déjà une constitution toute faite et il avait imposé, n'est-ce pas, aux autres?
Of course, it is true that at that time, those leaders overwhelmingly supported the outcome of the constitution, what came out as the federal constitution. At the time, most of the leaders were in accordance with it, especially the Southern Cameroon's House of Chiefs,
yes,
that actually gave they actually accepted it overwhelmingly. Mm-hmm. They supported the idea. Even the Southern Cameroon House of Assembly also accepted it, like ST Mona, like he talked about, also overwhelmingly confirmed that the constitution was okay. But we are historians and we are looking at it and making an analysis of what took place at the time, the facts on the ground. And what I was like saying is there are many of them who regret, like Foncha and Mona and the rest of them, they regretted what happened, what transpired.
We hear that Foncha even hid the documents which was to present in Fumban. Have you dug up what actually transpired? So yes, let's be clear in the minds of Cameroonians.
You see, I laugh there because a lot of controversy has come up on that issue of the fact that Foncha hit the document that was sent to it to him by French Cameroon. That French Cameroon actually sent them their own proposal, and Foncha did not show it to the rest of British Southern Cameroonian leaders, especially those of the opposition. There is a lot of controversy there. I'm coming to that. That opinion, that idea of, I don't want to call it fact because it is very controversial, is propagated mostly by Professor Julius Victor Ngo, who has done enormous, he's a learned professor of history and has done enormous research on that. And also, he has written a lot about that, saying that Foncha hid those documents. But we also have another learned professor of the University of Yaoundé, Professor Vicky Jikaji Fanso,
yes,
who has came up with some counter argument, thank you, to say that it wasn't possible for Foncha to have hit that. But Solomon, I don't I'm not in position to counteract what any of this, because these are learned professors and they have done enormous research on that. I am still doing some research on that to come up with my own finding as far as that is concerned. But I want to say that heaping blame on Funcha is not the focus here.
Yes.
The focus here should not be whatever Funcha did. We were not going to dig Funcha out of the grave to come and fix the problem we are facing now. We have to move ahead. Cameroon has to move forward. We will not dig Funcha. So I think that what baffled me is there are a lot of things that we discuss in Fuman that were not respected to the latter.
Like which and which?
Let me start with the amendment of the Constitution that was spelled out in Article 47 of the Federal Constitution. The Federal Constitution spelled out the method of amending the Federal Constitution. And an interesting part of Article 47 that most of the historians seem to be paying a blind eye to for reasons I cannot explain is the fact that Article 47 clearly spells out, and I will rephrase that, that any proposal for the amendment of this constitution that will go to impair the federal structure of the country shall be inadmissible. Any proposal for the amendment of this constitution that will go to impair the federal structure shall be inadmissible. That was what was clearly spelled out in Article 47, and that article has been violated by the 1972 referendum.
Yes.
That gives room to what we have today as 20th May. And the second part of it is the fact that that article spelled out the method of amending that constitution, and referendum was not one of those methods that was to be used.
So, une question, professeur.
The referendum was illegal.
Si l'article 47,
I'm not a constitutional expert, but in my view, in my reading, looking at Article 47, I will want to conclude that 1972 référendum was illégal.
Mais pourquoi, selon vous, une question, si vraiment l'article 47 de cette constitution avait été violé en 72, pourquoi cela n'avait pas suscité, n'avait pas poussé les autres à se soulever contre le président Aïdjo? Pourquoi ils avaient croisé les bras et observé?
Yes, I was coming to that because that same article spelled out how that constitution was to be amended. The article spelled out that for the Fumban Constitution, for the federal constitution to be amended, a proposed bill to pass through parliament, they needed majority of both sides, that is the English speaking parliamentarian members of parliament and the French speaking. And in the National Assembly at the time, the Federal Assembly, so to speak, there were 50 members, and 10 of which were British Southern Cameroonians, or time. Anglophones, and 40 were of a French Cameroon origin. And so that constitution, the Fumban constitution, the federal constitution, protected the right of the Anglophones by saying that for any bill to pass through, they needed a majority vote on both sides. That is to say, if four British Southern Cameroonians out of 10 vote in favor of the bill and 6 vote against, and even if all the 40 of La République, the French members of parliament of East Cameroon,
yes,
vote in favor of that bill, the bill will not go through. Ahidjo knew this so well and skillfully avoided that. He skillfully avoided that. He simply came to the National Assembly and informed members of the National Assembly that he wants to consult the people of the Republic and find out if they would choose between a federal structure and a unitary system.
Now, there's still some confusion between reunification and unification, historically speaking. Which is which?
There is no major difference between the two because both terms were used interchangeably throughout the period leading up to the plebiscite of 1961. Those terms were used by both the KNDP, political party of British Southern Cameroon, and the CPNC. They talked of unification. At one moment, they talked of reunification. So both terms were used interchangeably.
So we should celebrate reunification now?
Yes. Yeah, so
are we right to celebrate unification, or we know we are going to celebrate reunification, but should we, were we to celebrate unification or reunification? Or since both terms are used, what is needed is a celebration?
When we talk of us celebrating reunification, it gets me a little bit confused. Because 1972, again, was the date of referendum, that the referendum was conducted in the 20th of May 1972. It was not the day British Southern Cameroonians voted to reunite with the Republic of Cameroon. And so I don't know how we come to call that reunification. We are celebrating reunification. We are celebrating some kind of...
are you saying our own national day is not the day which ought to be celebrated?
No. I am saying that what I am saying is that we are celebrating some kind of annexation of British, of a former British Southern Cameroon by the La République du Cameroon. That is what
ce qui me permet de vous poser une question, prof, au sujet, n'est-ce pas? Parce que tout à l'heure, vous avez dit que le Cameroun, qu'il y a beaucoup de choses qui avaient été, n'est-ce pas, arrêtées en 72 à Fumban, mais qui n'ont pas été respectées. Et vous, on sait très bien que dans l'opinion, on dit très bien que ça fait 52 ans que le Cameroun francophone et le Cameroun anglophone se sont mariés,
entre guillemets.
Et on voudrait savoir, est-ce que les retombées, on dit qu'il n'y a pas de retombées positives pour les deux parties, notamment, et beaucoup plus pour la partie anglophone du pays. Comment est-ce que vous analysez, n'est-ce pas, cette perception de l'opinion de la chose?
Of course, going by what I have been saying all along, we will not say that it has all been a bed of roses between La République du Cameroun.
Since they got married.
The former Southern Cameroon. Because all what was agreed upon, all the terms for which the marriage was conducted were violated to some extent, which shows that even in Fumban, like many will hold, the delegate from British Southern Cameroon came to Fumban with an open mind, with a brotherly spirit. The people of La République du Cameroun, or the delegates from La République du Cameroun, had something else behind their mind. They had some degree of bad faith by the time they got there. Because right in Fumban, there was no intention to have the federal system last forever. Because not long after the Fumban Constitutional Conference, did I just start closing down some institutions in former British Southern Cameroon and transferring some to French Cameroon? And
was it not for national cohesion and maybe to unify the country for that?
That can be an explanation given to the president, President Ahidjo, that it was for national unity and the rest of it. But when we look at it very keenly, we start asking ourselves, why should that national unity be to the detriment of one part of the territory and not the other? Why was it that we didn't see a situation where some institutions in former French Cameroon were transferred into British Southern Cameroon? We only saw the institutions in west of the Mongo being transferred to the east. So it leaves one to wonder how genuine the leaders of French Cameroon were. And coming back to the question of how well the union had been, it has not, like I said, all been a bed of roses, because there are a lot of misgivings, a lot of dissatisfaction on the part of British Southern Cameroonians or Anglophone speaking Cameroonians. There are a lot of dissatisfaction. We have been hearing all of that. Of course, we know of even some radical arm of the Anglophone section who are even calling out rightly for cessation of the two territories. All of that.
Mais tout n'est pas que mauvais, professeur. Il y a quand même des retombées positives. Notamment, on se rappelle très bien qu'avant l'État unitaire en 72, il n'était pas possible pour les anglophones ou les francophones de traverser le pont du Mongo sans avoir à présenter un laissez-passer. Par exemple, ce qui couvrait, on avait deux assemblées nationales. Ça revenait trop
that
cher
was really
à l'État du Cameroun. On a mis fin à cela, on a mis fin aux barrières qui nous séparaient. On est devenu un seul pays. Et puis au niveau de l'intégration nationale, les anglophones peuvent s'installer, ils s'installent du côté francophone, tout comme les francophones s'installent du côté anglophone, notamment dans les villes de Bamenda et même de Boya. N'est-ce pas quand même quelques retombées positives, prof?
Yeah, there are a few cosmetic positive things we
sans compter les fils, les jeunes fils et filles du sud-ouest et du nord-ouest qui sont nommés à des postes importants. Le dernier en date, c'est notre frère, notamment de Libyalem, qui est DG de la CSPH à Yaoundé.
Yes, you see, when you talk of all of this, they sound very interesting, you see, because it gives the impression that what Anglophones are crying for are positions of appointment and here and there. Yes, it is true that there are a lot of there are a lot of issues in terms of appointment that gives British Southern Cameroon, gives Anglophone speaking Cameroonians the feeling that they don't belong. And you see, it is very hard to live in a country where you know your children will grow up knowing that they have limitations in that type of a country. This is because we have a number of ministerial positions in this country that seem to be a no-go zone for Anglophones, a number of them, and I am sure you all know some of those positions. But I think English-speaking Cameroonians are not asking for cosmetic political appointments here and there. They are asking for institutional reforms that will address the deeply entrenched, discrimination against the English-speaking Cameroonians. They need those reforms in terms of institutions. And when we talk of institutions, what are we talking about here? We are talking about going back to the drawing board, going back to where we began. How was this union conducted? What was the terms of the union? Let us go back.
Is it possible to go back? We are talking about moving ahead. You are taking us backward.
Yes, it is. You can talk of people telling, looking at us moving ahead, but we can't move ahead when things are not going on right. We must go back to drawing board. We look at how the things were set, and we try to put things straight and move ahead. We can keep moving ahead, and finally, in the next 100 years, we might not go anywhere. So it is better for us to take one step behind and have a great leap forward.
Prof, êtes-vous pour la sécession ou bien pour l'État unitaire?
And the one
third option might be the restoration of the statehood. People get confused about secession, restoring the statehood. So finally,
I personally do not agree with those who go the extra mile to ask for secession. That is not that I don't think is what is best for Cameroon. Now, what I think should be the solution to this problem, there is one.
Yes.
And that one problem is a federal system of government. We'll talk of decentralization.
Regions are there.
Yes, but you yourself know that decentralization, as we find it, is decentralization on pieces of papers. Changing names of provinces to regions does not make decentralization, because everything still is at the center. It is in Yaoundé. Everything is in Yaoundé. Everything comes from Yaoundé. There is no real decentralization per se. And so I think the best issue here, the best way to solve this issue, is for us to go back to the federal system of government. We might not necessarily go back to a two federated state, but I think I mentioned here that a radical group who are calling for secession, the SANC, had submitted case files to a number of international courts, and there has been one response that has come out: dialogue. The President of the Republic should engage genuine dialogue with members of the English-speaking community. When I talk of genuine, I mean talking with the real people. I know they will come up with the idea that, we don't know them, we don't know these people, but they keep arresting them all the time. Who are the people they arrest that they don't know them?
Are they representative enough?
They don't call them handful. That English-speaking Cameroonians do not go to the street to... I earlier said here when we were talking about the University of Boya that there are civilized ways of expressing issues, our grievances. We don't need to move to the street. We don't need to destroy properties. We don't need to cause violence.
Mm-hmm.
Regime listens well to those type of violence and so than to peaceful dialogue, because you see, the regime has been stubborn, and the regime should never pretend that they can suppress this whole issue. This can never be suppressed. You can only temporarily intimidate and frighten some group of people who might go underground and do one or two funny things out there that we may not know and may bust out into something that we may not be able to handle.
So as we celebrate 20th May, people will be marching past across grandstands. What should be on the back of their mind as we celebrate all Cameroonians, what should they be thinking about?
There are a number of them who do not seem to understand the real problems here. They don't seem to understand the real problems, and they just see it like some day that is being celebrated, and they call it National Day, and they know they are being patriotic to their country, and I think that day should be a day of reflection, a day of us coming back, looking at it. What was it? What was it that took place on the 20th of May? What happened? What transpired? What led up to that day? Was what happened on that day proper? Was it okay? Did it satisfy the wishes of all Cameroonians put together? If even one Cameroonian is not happy, a good leader should not go to sleep. He shouldn't go to sleep.
Une question, vous venez, professeur, de prononcer le mot patriotisme. Vous dites que ce jour-là, le 20 mai prochain qui arrive, sera l'occasion pour certains Camerounais d'exprimer le patriotisme. Est-ce que vous, en tant qu'historien, vous qui observez la scène politique depuis des années, vous pensez que les Camerounais sont suffisamment patriotes aujourd'hui?
That's a difficult one there. I have disturbing reactions coming from especially the young people when it comes to talking about the country. It is not good at all. It's not good at all. What comes from the young? The other day, the mention of Cameroon's pride was made, and I got some young guys who expressed like, what is that? Which shows that love for country is not there. The young people do not love their country. They don't, that patriotic feeling. We are talking here about asking that they should be paid to go and march. Those are the type of things to tell you that the young elderly, people are not.
We are looking at the youth. Est-ce que les aînés sont aussi patriotes dans leur pays?
Public. See, when I become very disturbed with the young, it is because they are the future generation. Mm-hmm. But I'm not like saying that the elders are. They are better off. Many of them do not really love this country. There are many of them who go to public, they make public statements that make ones to wonder if actually they have this interest, the interest of this country at heart. And when we go again to look at those who swindle state funds, embezzled billions of CFA francs, you begin to ask yourself if they have another country elsewhere that after destroying this country, they will go.
Voilà, une dernière question, si vous permettez, chers collègues. Alors, professeur, nous célébrons le 20 mai, l'état unitaire. Et nous savons très bien que notre territoire est attaqué de toutes parts. On a du côté de l'Est, notamment, n'est-ce pas, dans la zone de Garoua-Boulaï, où ces derniers jours, nos militaires, notamment nos valeureux éléments du BI, ont eu des accrochages avec des membres de la CELICA. C'était entre le 14 et le 15 mai dernier. Avant cela, on a eu une incursion de la CELICA du côté de Kenzo, toujours à l'Est, où ils ont carrément, n'est-ce pas, tiré sur des habitations et libéré 4 de leurs membres et amené un de nos policiers. En dehors de cela, Boko Haram, qui du côté du Nord est très actif, enlève des gens. En mer, Bakassi Freedom Fighters et beaucoup d'autres des bandes armées qui nous dérangent. Est-ce que, n'est-ce pas, tous ces éléments qui se passent dans notre pays, et aussi avec le thème qui est Armée et Nation, vous pensez que on peut vraiment célébrer le 20 mai en toute sérénité et continuer, n'est-ce pas, avec un pays dont on dit qu'il est en paix et tout, et qui vit dans la cohésion sociale?
Yes, we find this sporadic attacks here and there, should be the question of national security. How secure are we? Mm-hmm. What is the level of our security? But I think overwhelmingly there are not going to be any major incident around. Mm-hmm. I don't think there is going to be any major incident, but everything is going to go on serene as far as I'm concerned. But I think those in charge should make sure that the insecurity around our borders, because most of those incidents they take place at our borders. I think the security around our borders should be strengthened to avoid some of those incidents.
Okay. Now, at this point, Prof will take a breather. We'll go to the Bakassi Peninsula, where some locals there mounted barricades or destroyed some public structures in the wake of protests against the way the administration was handling the area. You know about the Bakassi Peninsula. So Davidson Maimous, a reporter, traveled to the Bakassi Peninsula. He says security is not totally guaranteed despite the presence of different elements of our different defense and security forces. It is a special report.
The presence of heavily armed Batallon Intervention Rapide, the B element, standing at strategic positions during the visit of the senior divisional officer for Ndian Division to install the new divisional officer for Bamuso Subdivision, and the dispatchment of the Marines from Mondimba and the Jemi from Boya are all indication that insecurity still looms within the area, or better still, the government is not leaving any stone unturned to maintain total security in the subdivision. But why there's so much tight security?
The new divisional officer has a serious task ahead of him. One of such tasks is maintaining security within the subdivision. The subdivision is very large and is made up of various creeks. And the people of this area are mostly foreigners. And most often, they agitate, bringing out their grievances in the form of strike action. It has just been not more than 2 months ago whereby there was a strike action within this area where some houses were burnt down. But the timely intervention of the forces of law and order and the administration actually put everything under control.
On the 6th of March 2018, reports say a group of foreigners who were alleged to be of Nigerian nationality attacked, destroyed, and burned down the chief palace at Bekomo, the economy headquarters of Bamuso Subdivision in the Dian Division of the Southwest Region. The lone hotel in the area, owned by the mayor of Bamuso Council, was also destroyed, and other buildings, such as the Marine Marshal office, was not left out, as their two boat engines equally disappeared.
The recent crisis took place in Bekomo, where a group of, I can call them vandals, were brought from Nigeria by some unscrupulous fellows from Bekumu to come and carry out vandalistic attitudes, burning and looting. I had to go there first. I was the one who went there first with the brigade commander. And it was horrible. I look at it as a planned act because we've never had that before. The mayor's business place was broken down and burned.
Molende Lawrence Loma, the secretary to the Bamuso Traditional Council, narrated the story from the Genesis.
So what happened? 6th March 2013 is a story to remember, but actually it occurred in two phases. The first phase occurred at about 4 to 6 o'clock when I was absent. Meanwhile, the second phase occurred at midnight when people were struggling to see how they can survive by hiding. But to survive by hiding in the forest, some in the forest, some in their residence. And it was just a crowd of angry Nigerians trying to express the state of their anger on the level they themselves best can explain. But it was later, after everything has died off, I discovered that there was destruction. They destroyed the palace and even the mayor residence and some other places. And many innocent people were also involved in the destruction. The houses were burned, some other items of people were being destroyed, just like that.
The Secretary General of the Nigerian Union in Bekomo, just like the Nigerian chiefs, all distanced themselves from what transpired on the 6th of March. But the destruction caused are still very visible. The destruction is said to have hampered the economy of the area and the whole of Bamuso Subdivision. This generator is being used to supply electricity in the entire Bekomo, which is the biggest fishing port in the whole of West Africa. But as the generator is standing, it can no longer function, as it equally suffered from the hands of those who were destroying and burning down structures. Only those who can afford to buy a small home generator can presently have light in their house at night. The chief of Bamuso and his entire family are reported to have narrowly escaped through the mangroves for their lives.
When the incident occurred, the chief only struggled to see how he can like defend his or herself, himself, and that of his family. By leaving the place from that particular moment, including with the help of the gendarmes from Bamuso to Bamuso.
So President, has the chief returned?
Presently, the chief has not returned, but he's in Bamuso today. Yes, it's Bamuso struggling to see how he can go back to his area of work.
Now, there are some allegations that probably Cameroonians may have hands in this thing. But how can the chief not be on the sea and the region chief is put in place?
You know, for instance, for in the case of the region chief that we are talking about, as the chief was absent, the people who are concerned concerning the kingmakers in the area, you know, Bekun is being made up of Bamuso. It's been made up of Bamuso, and our area here we have both Bamuso and Yenda. This place you are standing is being divided into two. You have the Yendas and you have the Bamuso. And that chief, the chieftaincy or the throne there you are talking about is being occupied by a Bamuso person. And it is the Bamusos they decided to put a regent chief in the absence of the chief. If there is other, if there is any other thing, I don't know how they have made it up to this extent, I don't know.
Some sources who preferred to be anonymous said the main cause of the attack is as a result of the mayor increasing the taxes paid by business persons.
I just want to use this opportunity to thank the government for the assistance, especially the governor, who indeed was so prompt to take his action and make sure there is peace. I want to assure you there is peace in the municipality, especially in Bekun. Right now, I'm telling you, security officers are already there, proving that the government loves the people of Bamuso. Everybody is entitled to pay his or her taxes. Now, the meeting was for a kind of sensitization meetings that they have to know that they are supposed to pay their taxes. And those taxes, they asked me as the mayor to align taxes, and the divisional chief of taxation was there to make it clear to them that these are deliberated things, that it is a must for everybody who resides in Cameroon, be you a Cameroonian or a foreigner, you have to pay your taxes.
With allegations that you drastically increase the taxes, that is why there was some agitation.
That is why I call it sensitization. A budget has been passed, just like in the parliament. Now, it is because those who carry on this thing, I don't want to say that they were some other forces behind, but I want to say that they were ignorant of what they were doing. And that was why that meeting was called, to sensitize them and tell them that the mayor has no right to increase taxes. Those taxes are taxes that were deliberated, and they were in the 2013 financial code.
I think that was just it's a plan that they had long ago. I cannot conclude that it's because of taxes, because the issue of taxes has been managed by us, the administration, and we've never had this attitude. So it's just like a wicked plan of some disgruntled people here in Bekumu who perhaps don't like the system.
The government is still going on with her investigations as the result of why the attack and who are those that were behind the attack is yet to be known. The attack, according to some pundit, has simply come to meet the government of Cameroon to understand that a lot needs to be done in as far as security is concerned within the country maritime borders.
The state of insecurity is that for immediate intervention, we need good forces that could like somehow stop incident like that immediately, since we only have just police and some branches of gendarme that have been sent from Bamuso to Bekumu. And with the population, with that amount, that police and the amount of gendarme, they cannot solve situations of about situations of about, to the best of my understanding, as I can measure, to about 3,000 Nigeria that are in Bikumu or more than.
It should be recalled that a gendarmerie post at Bamuso has once been attacked by gunmen who opened fire at the building, making away with the gendarmerie engine boat. Presently, our investigation shows that the gendarmerie and the police do not have an engine boat to move from one island to the other, talk less of a good structure that resembled a security post. Even the well in front of the gendarmerie has dried off. This boat belongs to other state services such as education, Menipia. Maintaining the engine of this boat has been a serious problem, as gradually the boat are depreciating without being used. Educationally, most of the students and pupils in Bamuso subdivision, especially those at the fishing port, are of foreign nationalities.
What's your name?
My name is Bright Efi Amabo.
How is school?
It's fine.
So what are you learning?
I'm learning mathematics, English, literature, etc. I want to be a mathematician.
That's good. Hey, what's your name?
Grace Jimmy.
Huh?
Grace Jimmy, though.
Yeah, what form are you?
From one.
From one. High school?
Fine.
So what are you learning?
I'm learning mathematics, English, literature, etc.
Yes.
The schools are in need of teachers to educate the innocent children, be them foreigners or Cameroonians.
I just help. I'm a part-time teacher. I'm the chief of center for history in the community. I just take part-time in this school. So since there are no science teachers.
So far, what is the situation?
No, at least the students are trying. You know, they are from Nigeria, where education, they don't even understand English, Pidgin, nothing. So they always speak their dialect, but we are doing our best.
Bamuso subdivision is one of the subdivisions within the Bakassi Peninsula, and therefore there is need for total security within the subdivision itself.
Thanks once again, David Sinmaimo, with a report from the Bakassi Peninsula. You watch with us, Rischard Ndifor, your historian. You watch the spate or the increase of insecurity in the Bakassi Peninsula. What is your take on the upsurge of attacks or the increasing attacks of Cameroonian positions by either armed groups or by the locals who simply decry the way they have been managed by Cameroonian authorities?
It is really a sad situation we just watched there, Solomon. I think that the government needs to strengthen the security of Bakassi, because that is a very, very delicate area, and we know that Nigeria is expected to hand over the territory officially to Cameroon, and I think that the government should do more to strengthen the security of that area and to put in place enough administrative structure, because of course they have been doing they have been contributing something, they have been doing a lot to the security of the area, but they need to strengthen that and ensure that the people of Bakassi live in peace. They don't live with one eye closed and one eye open. I think it is necessary for the government to strengthen the security of the Bakassi Peninsula.
Voilà, c'est juste une question.
Oui, justement une question, mais qui n'a rien à voir avec Bakassi, avec les protestations, ou n'est-ce pas ces actes posés par nos frères de Bakassi. Une question qui a plutôt trait au Sénat. On sait qu'une nouvelle page de l'histoire du Cameroun est en train de s'écrire.
I don't want to think that it is because of the age of the members, even though that is a concern of many Cameroonians, that some of
puisqu'on attend le président du Sénat.
Yes, some of whom describe it as a retirement home for old people or former ministers. But I think the reason why it is taking this long, we understand that the House of Senate is new for in Cameroon, and many of those who are in the Senate, need a lot. They are not experts in law and all of that. So they need to take their time and come out with a document that will reflect the type of senate that we want for Cameroon. I don't think that they should hurry over it. 3 days is it's not too bad, and I think
c'est presque une semaine. On va attendre combien de jours, combien de semaines pour avoir le président du Sénat?
They need sufficient time to work out a document that will befit the type of senate we want in Cameroon. It's not a document.
Selon nos reporters qui sont à Yaoundé et qui couvrent, n'est-ce pas, les travaux du Sénat, il nous revient que justement nos sénateurs n'arrivent pas à tenir 6 heures de travaux d'affilée. Vu leurs âges, c'est pour cela que je vous pose la question.
Est-ce qu'on
va pouvoir voir cela de manière rapide, juste parce que ça c'est un problème quand même.
That's interesting. I've not heard about that yet, and it will be sad if that is what is happening. But I still believe that we should give them some time to come out with a perfect work.
A senate for Cameroon, historically speaking, where should we put that? Was it important so much? For a country.
That is a good one. You know, there has been a number of questions about the importance of the Senate in Cameroon. I was reading the papers recently and got the analysis of an constitutional expert that made me even start questioning what is the importance of a Senate for Cameroon. Because going by what the expert wrote, the National Assembly is in effect more stronger than the Senate. And the Senate seemed to be some kind of paper tiger, because bills that emanate from the National Assembly and get to the Senate, even if the Senate have to reject those bills by a simple majority, if it gets back to the National Assembly can still pass the bill by a simple majority and it will go through. So it leaves the question, what is really the importance of the Senate? Because even bills that are submitted to the Senate, even if after the Senate adopts it, the Senate does not send those bills directly to the President of the Republic. It comes back to the National Assembly, and it is the President of the National Assembly that sends it to the President of the Republic. And of course, going further, in the Constitution, they say there's an institution of deadlock between the Senate and the National Assembly. The president of the republic gives the final say to the National Assembly, and of course true to that, because the National Assembly is reflect the will of the majority of Cameroonians, because they were voted in by direct universal suffrage and not by indirect universal suffrage, like the case of this.
Ce que vous dites est très pertinent, prof. Mais j'ai quand même une question. Si, comme vous le dites si bien, vous faites référence à l'expert qui, d'après son explication, démontre par A plus B que l'Assemblée nationale reste plus forte que le Sénat. Alors, qu'est-ce qui explique donc que les sénateurs aient tellement d'avantages, notamment 3 millions de francs de salaire le mois, un 4x4, un garde du corps et puis une résidence, ce qui n'est pas le cas des sénateurs, des députés? Alors,
that is an explanation that only the President of the Republic can give us, and we cannot understand why, and it still goes with the same question.
Puisqu'on avait même vu on a même vu le président de l'Assemblée nationale se battre pour vouloir pour être sénateur, mais on lui a dit de se calmer.
We have already started hearing indications that members of the National Assembly are already calling for a pay rise. Because they are really hearing that members of the
Senate. When we were discussing, you raised the issue of the constitution not being applied. But in this case, we see that even though people are saying it's 17 years after, the constitution has been applied. Is that not good news for the country?
17 years after?
Yes.
Yes.
No, do you see, that is some of the problems we have in this country where aspects of the constitution are being applied piecemeal. You see, they go here and pick what they think will be to the interest of the powers that be, and they apply. They go here and pick. Otherwise, what explains the reason that 17 years after this constitution was adopted in the National Assembly, it is today that it is being applied? Again, we find a situation where Article 66 of the Constitution is still lying in the drawers of the President of the Republic and has still not been applied. Those are some of the things that bother some of us, and some people are even quick to say that Cameroon is the only country in the world that runs two constitutions simultaneously. And I think it is a worrisome situation. Of course, the president will obviously have his explanation, and he will tell you that he has the problem of finances to put in place those institutions and all of that. But of course, that was the weakness of the same constitution, because the constitution spells out that those aspects, some of the aspects of the constitution, will only be applied piecemeal, progressively.
So progressively means it might
take the next 20 years, it might take the next. Yeah, so that is the weakness. Years. That is the weakness of our constitution.
Now, at least
President Biya is working within the law. He is working within the law.
Before we move to the studio, we heard how Elections Cameroon 2 is so far saying that the position of voters using the biometric system is to continue as from April or from May the 22nd. Now, I wanted to try to revisit the history of our electoral process from the election organized by the Minister of Territorial Administration to ONEL, ONEL 1 and ONEL 2, then now to Elections Cameroon. Don't you see some progress being made?
Yes, I think progress being made, of course, true. I think if we have to go back to the whole history of our electoral process since the reintroduction of multi-party in Cameroon, it is a very, very, very long story, and we might not have the time here to say all of that. But I think the major problem with our electoral system is the fact that we don't even have a calendar of election. In other countries, if you go to the United States, you know that elections are supposed to be held on a second Tuesday or a second Wednesday of this month after this number of years. But in Cameroon, it's unfortunate that the calendar of elections in Cameroon is at the chest of the President of the Republic. He decides when and where. We might just get up tomorrow morning and he calls the Electoral College, convenes the Electoral College. And so the electorate, he might convene the electorate in the next day, and that is a very serious problem. And that is why you find this irregularity with ELECAM. I was one of those who criticized the decision of ELECAM to suspend registration, because we all know what the law says as far as that is concerned, that elections were supposed to begin on the 1st of
registration
was supposed to begin at the 1st of January and runs through to the 31st of August. And but that was not the case. ELECAM, I don't know for what reason, decided to violate that part of the law. If after having reflected over it and they realized that what they did was not correct and they have to come back to that, then we will have to appreciate that.
Voilà, sur le plan historique, quand vous revenez, n'est-ce pas, en arrière, vous voyez que, justement, le Cameroun fonctionne avec deux constitutions. Est-ce que vous pensez que, 17 ans après, si on n'avait pas eu à fonctionner avec ces deux constitutions, sur le plan historique, cela aurait eu un impact positif pour notre démocratie?
Non, it doesn't have a positive impact. On the other hand,
non, la question c'est de savoir si on avait fonctionné avec une seule constitution depuis 96, sur le plan historique, l'histoire aurait retenu que nous avons avancé ou pas.
Exactly, we would have moved a long way into the. Would have gone a long way in a democratic process, rather than this idea of progressively putting in things. And you see, we find difficulties here and there. What I believe is, if since then, since 1996, when this constitution was drafted, if the constitution was put in place, we would have discovered some elements of it that would have warranted us to make some amendment, make some changes there. Because, of course, as we stay now, the constitution as we find it is not a good one for us. It's not a good constitution. There are many elements in the constitution that need some restructuring to be able to give us the type of democracy,
the advanced democracy
that we are talking about. There are a lot of elements in our constitution. You see, we took 7 years renewable ones, and then as far as the term of office of the president is concerned, and then we moved again from 7 years renewable ones to 7 years known or renewable as many times as possible. Mm-hmm. And then even when we took 7 years, 7 years was we copied that from France, and France had long abandoned the issue of 7 years, and they're now 5 years. And Cameroon is one among
several African countries.
Yeah, I think just about two of them in Africa that has such a long term of office for the president, a term of office that is almost a two term of office in some other countries.
Now, Prof, we're wrapping up the program. We are within the context of 20th May celebration. So what should Cameroonians have in their mind? Should we continue to celebrate 20th May through March past, or are there other possibilities of maybe organizing debates, round tables, and educating the Cameroonian people on what the 20th May is all about?
If I was in a position to decide as to which date to be celebrated, I would rather prefer that we celebrate the 11th of February 1961, not as Youth Day, because up to now, I don't know what the youth did on that day that we celebrate it and call it the Youth Day. There is nothing in history, nothing, not even a single element in history that tells us anything relating to what the youth did for that day to be called the Youth Day. But that day should be made the National Day of Cameroon, given that that was the day that what they call today brothers of La République du Cameroun and British Southern Cameroon, they actually, or those of British Southern Cameroon actually voted to reunite with their brothers, La République du Cameroon. And so I would think, in my personal opinion, that that should be the day to be celebrated, and not the 20th of May, because, like I said, the 20th of May, going by the Fumban Constitution, mm-hmm. is illegal.
Thank you, Roland Djotie. You work with Quotidien Economy for helping us interview Rischard Ndifor. Thank you sincerely for your time.
Merci, Solomon.
Thank you, Chupo, for traveling all the way from Boya to join us in a studio in Douala. It was a pleasure having you.
Thank you so much.
To you, televiewers, we thank you too for watching this edition of Meet the Press. Meet you same time next week. Until then, bye-bye, and may God bless you all.